I want to introduce to you Pastor Jeremy Isaacs. Pastor Jeremy is a friend of mine. He's been a coach, a mentor, just a great guy. He just loves churches. He loves people. He's a pastor in Canton, Georgia, and pastors Generations Church there. And he's coming to minister some good things to you today from God's Word. Would you give it up for Pastor Jeremy today? Come on, Jeremy.
Thank you, sir. Well, good morning, His Place. How we doing? Now, here's what I'll do. I'll tell you the same thing I tell my church. Whether you're in the room here with me or you're watching online, I'll be able to hear you somehow supernaturally. The louder you are, the more you talk back, the shorter I preach. So if you want me to spend all day here with you, then you're just going to sit there like a bump on a log, all right? But if you feel like, hey, I got some stuff I got to do this afternoon, you're going to respond back to me. If you help me preach, I'll help you, and we'll all have a good time, all right? Hey, here's the deal. I am so thankful to be here. I got in yesterday morning early. One of our staff pastors, Pastor Trevor Heineman, is with me, and we've spent the last 28, 29 hours or so, and we're looking to spend a few more hours here today with you and some of your staff and leaders. And so I'm thankful for what God is doing at His Place Church. And I don't know what your church background is. I don't know what your context of faith and church and ministry is. And I know that here's one truth that I absolutely know, including my own church. There is no such thing as a perfect church. But I will tell you that this is a phenomenal church. And you have incredible pastors. Do you love Pastor Doug and Kim? They are unbelievable. Absolutely. Go ahead. You know, there is no such thing as a perfect church, but this is one of the best churches I've been in a long, long time. And I don't just say that. I promise you. I really believe that God has great things in store for this church. And what Pastor Doug said earlier, I believe that the best days of His Place Family Church is right in front of us. And so I'm thankful for that. I'm thankful to kind of be on the journey with you from a little bit of a distance, but I'm thankful that I get to come and visit you and be a part of what God's doing here. And I can't wait to hear all that God continues to do in the days ahead. He mentioned just a second ago, I pastor Generations Church. It's in Canton, Georgia, which is about 45 minutes north of downtown Atlanta. If you're going towards the North Georgia mountains, we say we're about halfway between Atlanta and the mountains, and so we get the best of both worlds. He asked me last night how far I am from the Atlanta Braves new stadium. I am 31 minutes from my driveway to the parking deck, give or take 10 or 20 seconds. I know how long. I got three boys that love to play sports, so we go to some games. My daughter's a cheerleader. This is my family there. I asked them to throw this up there on the screen for us, and yeah, absolutely. I think that they're awesome. My wife, Corey, is the one in the hat there, and she's the best thing that's going for me. We met when we were 13 years old. We were at a summer camp, a youth camp. So students, if you ever get the opportunity to go to a camp or retreat, God will bring great things into your life. I was walking down a sidewalk going this way, and she was walking down the sidewalk going the opposite direction. When she passed me, I started going the opposite way. I just got in behind her. I've been following her the rest of my life. And then we have four kids. Cooper is 16, Branson is 14, Tucker is 12, and little Miss Kinley's 10 years old and runs the show. And so I'm thankful for my family. They couldn't be here today. My kids and my wife, my family, they are at our church, and they are serving today. And so I'm thankful for that. I'm thankful for what God's doing in our life as well. Here's what you need to know about me. I am somewhat reflective. I love to reflect. I love to look back. I love to look ahead. I love to dream new dreams and think new thoughts. But I really do get a little bit reminiscent, on a pretty regular basis. I got to be honest. While I'm driving down the road, sometimes I'm thinking back to, you know, great experiences and things that I've thought through and things that I've experienced, things that have happened to me in my family, in the church, and in life in general. And so what happens is, as I reflect, I begin to project. I begin to think about what may be in the future and what I can learn from the things that I've experienced in the days before. And so every year around Thanksgiving, I tend to get a little more reflective, and I begin to process what's happened in this past year. And I know it's not Thanksgiving yet, but you know, what's happened in this last year? What's 2020, 2021? What has it been like for you? What is, you know, what's happened in 2019 and 2018? Kind of think back over the last few years, and all of us have walked through, you know, kind of some of the things that have been taking place globally and nationally and even regionally or in your community and personally in your family. Maybe it's been an incredible year or two or three in a personal way or in a business sense, or maybe you've experienced some of the same struggles that other people have experienced. But as I begin to reflect back, that's really where I ask God to help to give me a sense of what God may want to do in the future, what He may want to do in this next year, what He may want to do in the next 3 months or 6 months or, you know, the next few years of my life, in our marriage, in our family, in our church. And so I began to ask God, God, give me some things. It's not New Year's resolutions that I'm praying for at that time necessarily, but sometimes those come, right? We say, hey, I wanna lose a little weight next year. I wanna exercise a little more. I wanna save a little more money. I wanna spend a little less money. I wanna spend a little more time with those that I love. And so, you know, those are things that definitely come out in moments like that. But for me, what I have been asking God to do over the last few years is that whenever I am reflecting, God, give me a word, give me a theme, give me something that kind of puts your stamp on what is out in front of me. And again, this supersedes, it's kind of larger than goals and larger than resolutions. It's really more of a thematic idea of, God, what is it that you are trying to accomplish in and through my life? And 2 years ago, the word that's up on the screen, or maybe that you see there on the computer screen where you're watching online, was the word stretch. That was the word that I felt like the Lord just laid on my heart in my car as I was driving. And I kind of thought, okay, well, this is my theme word for the year. And I got to be honest, it's lasted more than a year. It's lasted more than 2 years now. It's something God is still trying to do in my life. And so as Pastor Doug, you know, gave me the opportunity to share today, I was praying through what I would share, and this felt like something that I believe the Lord wants to deliver through me today to you. And so here's what I want you to know about this idea of stretching. I want you to get this picture in your mind of a rubber band, right? A rubber band is something that as you hold it in your hand, it just sits there. But as you begin to stretch it, it has the capacity to do more than what you thought when it was sitting still in your hand. You could, you know, pull it to double or triple its size. You could put it around a, you know, a stack of papers. You could put it around something that you need to store, bind together. And so there's definitely the ability for it to stretch. I remember I played sports when I was younger in high school and then into college. And I remember the mundane part of the beginning of every practice where coach would say, all right, everybody run out to the outfield and start stretching. And I got to be honest, there were a lot of times I'd kind of mail that in. I just did not give it 110%. I was ready to hit or throw. I was ready to shoot. I was ready for us to block and tackle and all the things that we wanted to do. But he wanted us to start by stretching. Now, I didn't always do it when I was younger, but when I was younger, maybe I didn't need to quite as much, but I'm not quite as young as I used to be. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. By and by. Our church has a church softball team. And so I play on that church softball team every now and then. It takes me a few weeks after every game to recover, so I don't play every week. It's now I'm kind of an every other week thing. I played this last Thursday with our team, and I told my wife right before the game started, I said, I made a grave error today. I made a huge mistake. She said, what did you do? I said, I didn't take my preventative 3-Aleve. I normally take 3-Aleve before the game and then 2 or 3 after the game, and that helps keep the muscles working the way they're supposed to. I got an amen right there more than I did anything I've said so far. So some of you know what I'm talking about, or maybe I just look like I need it. But the idea is that, you know, I don't really stretch before church softball. I don't, you know, maybe I should. Maybe now in my age, I just should stop playing altogether. But I don't really stretch before church softball. A few years ago, I was playing softball, and you know, I'm not gonna act like I'm some home run hitter all the time or whatever. But I hit a ball and it hit in the gap and it got between the outfielders and went all the way to the fence. And I thought, whew, all right, here we go, all right. And I took off running like I was being chased by somebody holding a knife. I mean, I was running as fast as I could get these little fat legs to go. And so I took off and I hit first base and I turned. And as soon as I turned towards second base, I heard it pop. And some of you can experience that. You know exactly what I'm talking about. I heard it pop and I pretty much crawled to second base the rest of the way. Not very athletic, but a couple days later, I found out that I'd torn my hamstring, and I thought, man, this is gonna take a while to heal and recover. And over the next few weeks and the next few months, what happened is I determined that when you don't stretch, you actually limit what you can accomplish. Because I didn't stretch before that game, so I wasn't able to accomplish everything that I wanted to accomplish. Even what I thought was going to take place, I had a good hit, but I couldn't actually fulfill everything that needed to take place at the end of that thing because I hadn't stretched to prepare myself to accomplish everything that needed to be accomplished through that moment. And I believe the same is true in your relationship with God. I believe the same is true for this church. I've spent the last, again, 24 hours or so with your leaders and your pastors, and I met some of you this morning. I've talked to you about your faith story and your faith journey and what God has done and how God brought you to this place and what you love about this place. And I love hearing those stories. And here's what I know. I know this about churches because I've been in the church literally all of my life. I was born on a Tuesday and I was in church on Sunday. All of my life I've been in the church. And here's what I know about churches, including your church. You love your church and you may not love everything about it, but when we talk about stretching and when we talk about change, we love change until we have to change anything that we do. right? Because you've got a spot you like to sit. You've got some songs you like when they sing. And when they don't sing your songs or somebody sits in your spot, you think, well, this is the devil fighting against me right now. This is what's happening. This is spiritual warfare. I don't know what. And then perhaps it's not spiritual warfare. Perhaps God is stretching and enlarging this house. And he's enlarging this camp, and that there are people, just maybe there are people that are driving by this road, and they're driving by this facility right here, and supernaturally the Holy Spirit is drawing them to this place the same way that he drew you to this place. Maybe somebody on your job, you hear them talking about pain or hurt or uncertainty or doubt about their future. You hear them talk about some things that are happening in their life and relationship. And in that moment, the Holy Spirit, that still small voice in your life, says, hey, this is your spot. This is the moment where you could invite them to come and be. We're starting a brand new series. You hear them talking about the turmoil of the world, and you say, hey, this next Sunday, my pastor's starting a new series called Stand Up. He's talking about how we can take a stand in the midst of all of the, we're going to read some Bible stories and talk, and they would come. But guess what? When new people come, they sit in your seats. And when new people come, they don't know how awesome you are, and they've got to learn those things. But I believe that God desires to stretch this house. And it might mean that even though we're comfortably in this place, that we got to go to two services or three services, or we've got to enlarge the tent and enlarge the place of meeting. We got to come up with some places. And I'm not casting vision to you. I'm not telling you something like your pastor's been telling. I'm just saying, like, I believe about churches that God desires that if we would create empty space, he would fill it. That's the story we read of that Old Testament prophet when he comes to the widow and she says, hey, I've got some debt and I've got some sons, and the leaders are trying to take my sons to pay off this debt. And the prophet says, well, what do you have? And she said, I have just this one little jar of oil. He says, well, I want you to go and borrow all the empty jars that you can from all of your neighbors. I love that there is a community part of this incredible story, that it takes other people to help you fulfill what God desires to do in and through you. And so she goes and gathers empty jars from all of her neighbors, and she comes back and she shuts herself and her sons into the house, and she begins to pour the oil out. Just the little bit of oil that she started with, she begins to pour it out into the empty jars that she's collected, and she continues to pour oil out until there's no more emptiness. And what I tell our church on a regular basis, and what I would say to His Place Church today, is as long as you will create empty space, God is on the hook to fill it. But wherever we tell him we are full, there is no more room for anyone else, he will move on down the street and find another place to help meet the needs of people who are hurting and lost in this community. And so I would say we've got to keep our minds stretched and open to believe that there is more room here for people that are hurting in this community. And so here's what I want to do today. I want to read to you a verse of Scripture. It's a verse of Scripture that many of you are probably familiar with, maybe not everyone. But it comes out of the book of Ephesians, chapter 3. And when I felt the Lord kind of lay on my heart this idea of stretch, this is the verse that he took me to. Ephesians chapter 3, verse 20 says this. Now to him who is able to do exceedingly abundantly above all that we ask or think, according to the power that works in us. Now to him who is able to do exceedingly abundantly above all that we ask or think, according to the power that works in us. This is the closing kind of benediction, the closing prayer of the Apostle Paul as he closes this letter that he has written to the church in the city of Ephesus. And, you know, he writes a number of letters in the New Testament, and many of those letters he's correcting bad teaching or bad theology. He's correcting bad practice, the things that they're doing in their church that aren't really healthy for them and they don't draw them closer to God. But the letter here in Ephesians to this church in Ephesus is not really to correct bad teaching or bad theology. It's not really to correct them much at all. A lot of the theme of the book of Ephesians is to enlarge their thoughts towards God, to grow their faith, to believe that God is able to do exceedingly abundantly. We're actually going to read a couple of verses in just a few minutes from another place in the book of Ephesians, this letter that he's writing. And so as I started thinking about stretch, and I started thinking about what God might do, and I started reading this verse of Scripture, I made it a personal prayer. And so I want to spend the remainder of our time together today just breaking this one verse down, kind of phrase by phrase. If you got something you want to take notes, I encourage you to do that so you can maybe refer back to this at some point. The first thing that we read there is, now to him who is able. Now to him who is able. If our stretch doesn't start with God, it isn't sustainable. If this is just me becoming a better version of me, that's not really sustainable. That's not really something that's going to last for eternity. But if I start by saying, now to him who is able, it requires me to have a perspective that God is able to do exceedingly abundantly. and to recognize who He is and who He is in the earth and who He is in my life. And so when I think about that, I often kind of confront some parts of me about what I want to accomplish and what I want to see done in my own life and in my family and in my finances and in my church. And so maybe you're like me sometimes. Maybe you find yourself in a place where you have a financial need and your first thought is, I gotta work overtime. But my first thought perhaps is, I gotta work harder. I've gotta generate some new income. I gotta come up with some ways to create passive revenue. And I gotta come, whatever that thought is. Now, I believe in working hard. I believe that working hard is God honoring. I believe it's worship unto God. But if our first thought about provision is trying to provide more for ourselves and not to turn to God as our source, I think we potentially have missed the point. When we perhaps get a bad doctor's report or maybe some uncertainty from the doctor, when the doctor says, hey, I want us to run a few more tests. I see a spot I don't like. I see some numbers that I'm not really sure about. If our first thought is, you know what, I need to exercise more and I need to eat better and I need, all of those things are right. All of those things are good. I believe we should do those and really take care of the temple of God that He's given to us. But if our first thought is not to turn to God, to see Him as the one who is able to do exceedingly abundantly, we've missed the point. Your pastor preached last week and he talked a lot about this idea of pray first. And what I believe is that prayer should be our first response and not our last resort. It shouldn't just be something we get to when we've exhausted everything that we can do and we go, well, all I've got left is to pray to God. No, our first thought should be, God, I'm going to come to You with the need that I have, with the situation that's going on in my life. God, I need You to be provision. I need You to be my healer. I need You to restore the brokenness of my marriage. I need You, God, to do what only You can do. We should acknowledge God first in our lives and not just as a last resort. And we should not just look to Him, but we should look to Him with a perspective that says He is able. Everybody say able.
Able.
Zechariah chapter 4 verse 6 says this. He said, so He said to me, this is the word of the Lord to Zerubbabel, not by might nor by power, but by my spirit, says the Lord Almighty. Now, Zerubbabel is a name that's found actually in the genealogy of Jesus Christ. When you read through the words of the early gospel there, when it talks about who kind of helped deliver Jesus to the earth in the line, the family tree there of Jesus, Zerubbabel is one of those names that's found there. But he's mentioned after the Babylonian exile, this part of the Old Testament narrative, this story is he helped lead God's people back home and he governed in Jerusalem and he helped to rebuild the temple there. And in Zechariah chapter 3, he has this vision of olive trees and lamps and he asks God, he says, what's the meaning of this vision as I'm trying to understand what You may be saying to me? And it's there in verse 6 that he says, you aren't going to rebuild this temple by your own might and your own power, but it's by the Spirit of God that's going to allow you to rebuild my temple. Amen. And so when I read through those things, I start to think about, well, what is might and what is power? Often we don't use the word might anymore unless we're talking about maybe military power. We talk about the collective strength of the military. They have a mighty army perhaps. And so we start talking about might being this collection of strengths. Well, I've told you a couple of times already, I've spent about 28, 29 hours here on the ground, and I've spent some time with your leaders. There are some mighty leaders within this church. There are some mighty things that are taking place and a collection of strengths that exist here. And as I sat with your leaders yesterday and I listened to their heart, and as we prayed together about what God might do, and as I've spent some time thinking about where God has positioned your church, it is amazing to believe that God might see this place as a place to pour out His Spirit and to really see this as a place where the lost can come to find life in Jesus Christ. There is incredible might, but if you try to do it on your own, you will fall short. Amen. It is not by might. Yep. Might is the collection of strengths. Right. But it's also not by power. What is power? Power is obviously individual. I have power. My car has power. It's something that's isolated. We see something, a personal strength that exists there. And I recognize that many people in this room, you have incredible strengths. You have incredible gifts. You go through the growth track and you discover that you're gifted in this way and gifted in that. You find out all of these spiritual gifts. If you've not been through the growth track, you need to go through the growth track. It's incredible to help you to understand all of the ways that God has uniquely wired you. When I was thinking about spiritual gifts, I remember as a kid hearing that list of spiritual gifts, not this exhaustive list, but kind of the compilation of gifts that's mentioned in a couple of places throughout Scripture. And I remember, you know, there's the gifts that, you know, kind of seem a little more spiritual sometimes. It's the gift of tongues and discernment and faith and wisdom and all, and it's like, oh man, I want those things. And then you hear, well, it's the gift of administration, and it's the gift of this and the gift, and then you start, oh, I think I want some of those. And then they would come to that one place where it says, you know, and maybe you have the gift of helps. And that just kind of sounded to me when I was younger like, maybe that was just an add-on. Like, if you don't have any of these other gifts, you got the gift of helps. It kind of sounded like something you put ointment on. I got the helps now. I don't really know how I got it, but I got it, and it was kind of spreading through the neighborhood, and I got the helps, and I need some help with it, I guess. And God is uniquely gifted in amazing ways, each individual person that sits in this room, each person that's watching online today. Amen. You have power. You have might collectively and individually. But if you try to use those things to build the church, you're going to fall short. Amen. If you try to use those things by themselves to make your family the best version of your family that this world has ever seen, you're going to fall short. If you try to use just those things, the might and power that you possess and the things that you try to do even in your own home to manage your finances and to stay pure and to stay right and to be a good business person and to be a good student and to be, if all of those things you're trying to pursue, if you try to do it in your own strength and your own power and in your own might, I promise you it will not last. What we read is that Zechariah says it's not by power, it's not by might, but it is by my spirit, says the Lord. Now to him who is able. Let's keep reading there from Ephesians chapter 3. Now to him who is able to do what? To do exceedingly abundantly. To do exceedingly abundantly. When I read that, and depending on the translation that you're reading of Scripture, you may see a few other words there. But exceedingly abundantly is something that really causes me to stretch my mind. Amen. It causes me to stretch my perspective. It really challenges me to think about how I view God. And so here's the question for you today. Is your God an exceedingly abundantly kind of God? Yes, now, the reason it got real quiet is because we're not really sure. So often what happens is that even though we put God in his rightful place, he's somewhere out there in the outer space, he's in the heavens, he's above me, he's beyond me. Really what we do is we construct God as kind of the best version possible of ourselves. In our mind's eye, instead of us being created in the image of God, we have constructed a God who is just like the best possible human being. Of all the great characteristics and qualities that we could possibly see on the earth, we just put all of those things together and we construct that view of who God might be. But that falls short. It falls well short of who God actually is. Isaiah 55 verses 8 and 9 says, "For my thoughts are not your thoughts, neither are your ways my ways, declares the Lord. As the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts than your thoughts." God's ways and his thoughts and his perspective, it's all different than ours. Amen. It's completely different. He's not just some better view and better version of who we are. He is immeasurably more. He is exceedingly abundantly more. He is completely different by his very nature. And then out of that nature, he created you and I. And he breathed his breath into us so that we could be his embodiment here on the earth. That's why Jesus, when he was teaching us how to pray in Matthew chapter 6, in verse 9, he says that when we pray this way: "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be your name." Before you can ask God to forgive us our debts, before you can ask God for our daily bread, we have to recognize that God is holy. He's different. He's set apart. He's in heaven with a unique perspective and a different place. And he possesses a greater understanding of all the things that we're walking through. You and I aren't praying to a God that's on our level. We're praying to a God who knows us personally, knows the number of ever-shrinking number of hairs on my head, but he is a God who knows us personally, and yet he is in the heavens. He has a different perspective. He has a different context of life and understanding. He is outside of the time that you and I are constrained by. He is outside of the strength that you and I are contained by. He's holy, and his name is hallowed, and he's set apart, and he's different. And that allows us to understand that he is a God who is exceedingly abundantly in every form and every fashion. A.W. Tozer says this. He says, "What comes into our minds when we think about God is the most important thing about us." What comes into our minds when we think about God is the most important thing about us. You and I don't possess a thought that's more powerful than the thoughts that we think about God. You and I don't have anything in our lives that is more precious than our understanding of who God is. And we can't just have an understanding and cling to that understanding without continuing to be stretched in that understanding, to believe that God is exceedingly, abundantly, he's able to do more than we could ask or imagine. One of the most famous stories in all of the New Testament and the Gospels, the stories of Jesus, is the feeding of 5,000. Anybody ever heard that story? right? Feeding of 5,000, it's a good story. I like any story that's about eating. I used to say I was a foodie. That really is just a fancy way of saying I'm an eater, right? I don't skip many meals, right? And so if I was there, I'd have been doing what those people did, as Jesus did what preachers do sometimes. He went a little long. He went into lunchtime. And it always amazes me when I read that story that no one had the thought that the preacher might go a little long. Like nobody except this one little boy. Well, I've got three little boys. It was not that little boy's thought to bring lunch. That little boy had a mama who sent a sack lunch with him and said, now, I don't know what his name is, but I'm going to call him Little Johnny because all of my stories have a Little Johnny. Little Johnny, listen, you're going to get hungry. Your blood sugar's going to drop. The preacher always goes long. So I want you to take something to eat when you start to get a little headache, you get a little winded. I want you to eat this sandwich. I got 2.5 fish sandwiches for you here in the sack lunch. I want you to take this with you when the preacher goes a little long. And so what happens is these other 4,999 plus are sitting there and they get hungry. And the disciples come to Jesus and they say, hey, it was good today. I need to really pray on those. That was really good what you preached there. But everybody's starving. They are. Did you not anticipate that like we needed to have like a little, you know, church homecoming after this thing was over and everybody bring a potluck? Like we're starving, Jesus. I don't understand. And Jesus does what Jesus always did. He looks back at them and he says, well, what do you have? Isn't it amazing that God could solve every single problem on the earth? He could meet every single need. And so often what he does is he comes back to me and to you. And he says, don't you want to be a part of this? That's what it's about to be in a faith community. That's what it's about to be a part of His Place Church. It's not to come. And as my youth pastor used to say, I think I quoted this yesterday, to come in and to sit, soak, and sour. You sit in a seat long enough, you just sit there, you just soak it all in, and eventually you just get sour. But the best thing that you can do is come and be a part of what God's doing by contributing to that in a variety of ways, to give and to serve and to be in a group and all of these things. Because what happens is God says, listen, I could do this all on my own, but what Jesus models for us here by the disciples, he says, what do you have in your hands? It's what Moses found when Moses continued to tell the voice of God out of the burning bush. When God was calling him to go and to set his people free, Moses was like, no, I don't, I got a stutter. I don't really talk. So, I mean, I can't go to Pharaoh and I can't be the mouthpiece of the, I can't really, you know, and he just continued to tell God time after time after time that he was not the man for the job. Anybody ever felt that way? Yeah. I feel that way. Yeah. Where I don't believe that when God's calling me to something, he's asking me to accomplish something great, that I could be the one that God would use. And so God does this amazing thing. First of all, he solves that whole problem. He says, I'm going to send Aaron. He'll go. Moses still had to speak. If you read that story, Moses still had to receive the word of God and say it to Aaron so that Aaron could deliver it to the people. God didn't let him off the hook. You and I can't get out of what God is calling us to do. It's just going to chase us all the days of our life until we finally say, God, I'm saying yes. You know, but God does this other amazing thing other than giving him Aaron. God asks Moses. He says, what is in your hand? He said, well, it's just this staff. It's just this shepherd's staff. It's just this stick. And so the voice of God out of the burning bush says to Moses, he says, okay, well, throw it down. And he throws it down and it turns into a snake. And then God says something inconceivable to me. Amen. God says, now pick it up. At which point, if I were Moses, I'd have been like, nah, I'm good. I'm good. I'm all right. This was cool what you just did. You pick it up. You make it a stick again, I'll pick it up. I ain't picking up a snake. It ain't that kind of church, God. We're out in the middle of the desert. I ain't. God says, no, you pick the snake up. He grabs it by the tail. It turns back into a stick. Now, here's what you need to see. In Moses' hand, it was the natural. This is a shepherd's staff. This is what everybody uses out here in the desert. You know, we got to keep the sheep in line. You got to have something to help keep them in order. It's just the natural. Everybody's outgoing like I am. I've always been this way. I've always been friendly. I've always been able to sing. I've always been able to play the guitar. I've always been able to organize things. And it's just natural. But when you release the natural to God, it becomes the supernatural. That's right. When you let it go and you say, God, I know this is just, I mean, it's just, I'm just friendly. I'm just helpful. I'm just kind. I think everybody's good at the things I'm good at. But when you lay those things down to God, God does what only God can do, and he makes it the supernatural. And then he does this amazing thing. He says, okay, now that you've released it to me, now that you've given me that gift, now that you've given me that thing, I want you to pick it back up. I want you to take it for yourself, and I want you to use it. This is going to be the demonstration of my power to the people that need to see my power. You take that stick, and if they don't believe you when you get there, you show them what I've shown you. So I promise you, as you start to think about this idea of stretching, as you start to think about this idea, is God an exceedingly abundantly type of God in your mind? Let's go back to that story of feeding the 5,000. This one boy has got 2.5 fish sandwiches in his sack lunch that his mama made him take to church. And Jesus asked the disciples, what do you have? And they go walking around. They say, well, we got this one boy. He's got, a couple loaves, a couple fish. Jesus says, bring it to me. They bring it to him. He prays over it, blesses it, breaks it. Cool picture of the same thing we see at the Last Supper, blesses it, breaks it. And then he gives it to them to begin to distribute to the crowd. And I love that God is able to meet the need. I love it. But my favorite part of this story is that after everybody had gotten full, the disciples went back and got baskets full of leftovers. Anybody like leftovers? Whew, there's something about leftovers. You know what I'm saying? It just, when it all sits together in the fridge for overnight, like it just tastes better the next day. It just all got down in there. And I don't know when they ate the leftovers. I don't know if the disciples ate them on the way to the next trip. Or I don't know if they gave them to the widows so that they could go home and have food for the next day. But the provision of God doesn't stop in the moment of your need. It extends beyond that. Our God is an exceedingly abundantly kind of God. He's not just able to meet the need that you have. He is able to exceed the need that you have. There are leftovers of God's blessings that you're still living in for prayers that he answered years ago. And you're just walking around living in the leftover blessings of what God provided for you back there. And maybe you thanked him back there. But when was the last time you thanked God for the leftover blessings you're still living in? You're still eating on. You're still chewing. God, thank you that I'm still living in the blessings, the exceedingly abundantly kind of blessings that you've given to me. You've got to stretch your view of who God is. Amen. You've got to change your perspective about who God is. He is not just a God who meets your need. He is a God who exceeds your need. And then we keep reading in Ephesians chapter 3. Who's able to do exceedingly abundantly? Above all that we can ask or think. Above all that we can ask or think. You saw my beautiful wife on the screen just a few minutes ago. My wife has never met an idea she couldn't come up with. I mean, we're just driving down the road and she goes, you know what would be a good idea? That always scares me. You know what we could do? We could just knock down the whole right side of the house and we could just turn it into this. And I'm like, okay, all right. Yes, we could. We could which child do we sell to make this happen? Like I'm trying to, we're going to put them to Kinley. She's 10. We're going to send her to Publix to bag groceries. And she's going to make some extra money to help us to fund this creative thought that we now have in our life. Like all that you can ask or think or imagine. I don't know what the grandest thought and idea that you have in your head. But what I'm reading is that God has bigger thoughts than that about you. That he has grander ideas about you. He has a bigger imagination about your life and your marriage and your family and your finances and your career and this church than you do. Pastor Doug's got some great dreams for his place, church. I've heard him share some of those dreams. There's others he probably hasn't even given me access to. But when he shares the dreams that God has laid on his heart for this place and what God can do, God has bigger dreams than that for this church. God has bigger thoughts than that for this church. He has a bigger imagination for what God can do through this place. Psalm 37:4 says, delight yourself in the Lord and he will give you the desires of your heart. And when I was reading that as a kid, I thought, whew, that's good because I got some good desires. I want God to give me all the things that I want. And let me just say to you that God is not your genie. He's not in a bottle for you just to go, hey, give me my 3 wishes. It's not about that. He is in relationship with you. I am in relationship with him. And what happens is as I delight myself in the Lord, I begin to desire the things that he desires for me. It changes my perspective. It changes my thoughts. It begins to align my will with His will for my life. We see that in the prayer of Jesus in the garden when He says, not my will, but your will be done. It is the idea here that I'm saying, hey, I have some things that I want. I have some things I'd like to avoid. I have some things I wish I could walk through. But you know what? I'm going to submit myself and take on your desires for my life because I believe that you are able to do exceedingly abundantly above anything that I could even imagine for myself. As I delight myself in the Lord, He does more. He does exceedingly, He does abundantly above anything that I could even think. Now, I don't know your context. I don't know the things that you would trust God for, but so often what happens in prayer, this is what I do, this is probably what you do. I don't want to indict you, but perhaps this is what you do as well. We pray with full faith and confidence until God doesn't meet that need. And then the next time we pray with a little less faith and confidence, and a little less faith and confidence until eventually we are praying for God to do something that if He doesn't do it, we can pretty much do it on our own. We're just trusting God. God, I need you to do these things. And our prayers become very general because if God doesn't meet the very specific prayer that we want to pray, we could really be okay with Him doing the very general thing that we could probably do without Him. But what I would say to all of us is that we need to pray very specific, bold prayers. Amen. Pastor Mark Batterson, he writes a number of books. One of those books was about prayer. It's called Circle Maker. And in that book and in a couple of other places as he's preached the content of that, he talks about praying bold prayers. And he says that God honors bold prayers because bold prayers honor God. He says that if I speak with confidence and faith in who God is and I pray with a boldness and a confidence to believe that He can, that I believe God responds to those kinds of prayers because He sees the level of faith we are exercising toward Him. God honors bold prayers because bold prayers honor God. You might even say it this way, you have not because you ask not. Amen. I remember my grandmother saying that when I was a kid. I thought, well, okay, let me ask for some stuff then. My grandmother would get the JCPenney's catalog and hand it to us and tell us to dog-ear the edge of the paper for the things we wanted for Christmas. I mean, when that catalog came to her house, it was like Christmas already because you were just every page. I want that, and I want that, and I want that, and I'm asking for that, and I'm asking for that. And then, you know, I had a conscience. My brother didn't. My brother would just keep asking for stuff, and I'd start to feel a little bad, and I'd say, Meemaw, is this okay that I'm asking for this many things? And here's what she'd say. She'd say, baby, it's just a Christmas list. You can ask for anything you want. I think so often we've stopped asking God for stuff. Because there were some times we asked God for some things that maybe we didn't see in the way that we thought we would see them. But here's what we read in Scripture. It actually says in James chapter 4, verses 2 and 3, that we do have not because we ask not. It says this. It says, you desire, but you do not have, and so you kill. Hopefully you're not doing that. You covet because you cannot get what you want, so you quarrel and fight. I know we do that. You do not have because you do not ask God. And when you ask, you do not receive because you ask with wrong motives, that you may spend what you get on your pleasures. As I delight myself in the Lord, He gives me the desires of my heart because my heart more desires the things that He desires for me. It's out of the right motives. It's out of the right perspective. It's out of the right heart that I'm seeking from God the things that I need. And so perhaps you would say, you know what? Well, I need a car. And it seems a little petty to ask God for a car. But if your motives are, you know, I can't get to work. I can't work a job. The car I've got, I'm spending more money to keep it running than I am able to provide for my family. Then ask God for a car. I believe God could supernaturally provide a car for you. It'll be a September to remember when you walk out of that house and there's a big old bow on that car and it says, to you, from God. Right? You don't think you'll shout the victory all the way up and down your driveway? People are going to call the police, say, they're crazy over here. I don't know what happened. Why won't you ask God for what you need? You say, I don't want to catch an Uber anymore. I want to be my own Uber driver. You say, well, that's something big. I don't know. Maybe you say, hey, I'm single. I don't desire to be single. I want a spouse. Have you made it a matter of prayer? Are we putting all of our hope and trust in the systems of this world to provide someone that we're compatible with? You say, God, I want someone. And perhaps God would turn it back on you and say, well, are you someone? Yeah. You got to be the someone that someone's looking for so that when you're looking for someone, they're the someone you're looking for. You got to commit your heart to God and chase after Him. And I believe with all of my heart, as you pursue God with all of your heart, He will give you the desires of your heart. Amen. Some of you have prayed prayers for your sons and daughters to come back home. Maybe physically, maybe more figuratively, you don't want them to move back in. You just want them to come back to faith in Jesus Christ. It's like, come back to the house of faith, but you live over there. It's fine. Again, I got another amen right there. I'm preaching okay, but you're amening in the wrong spots. You can ask God to bring your sons and daughters back home. Amen. You can ask God to restore broken relationships. You can ask God for the things that you need and the things that you want. You can pray first and believe that God is He's able to do exceedingly abundantly above all that we can ask or imagine. So the question becomes, do you believe that He can? When we change our mindsets from praying to a God that we hope can to a God that we know can, it changes everything that we do. So let's kind of wrap this stuff up as we start thinking about stretching our minds and our hearts. He says, according to the power that works in us. According to the power that works in us. None of what we've been talking about is possible in our own strength or in our own power. We've already talked about that. You and I have our own might and our own power, both personally and collectively. So how is this possible? Through His power, through the power of God. God doesn't just have power that He keeps for Himself. He also endues you with power. He gives you His power to do work on the earth. We've been reading kind of the closing prayer of Ephesians. Let's go back to some of the early verses of Ephesians chapter 1, verses 19 and verse 20 says this. I also pray that you will understand the incredible greatness of God's power for us who believe Him. This is the same mighty power that raised Christ from the dead. Paul ends his letter to the church at Ephesus by saying, hey, this is a God who's able to do exceedingly abundantly. But he begins that letter by saying that God has given you the power. And that power that He gives you is the same power that raised Christ Jesus from the dead. And so the question would be for all of us today, what are the dead things in our lives that need to be raised back to life? What are the dreams you dreamed years ago, but you laid them down because it seemed like it was taking too long and it seemed like it was too much work and it seemed like it wasn't going to happen and you just kept hitting roadblock after roadblock. You just kept banging your head against the wall because it just wasn't happening the way that you thought that it would. But according to His power, we've got to stretch our minds and stretch our thoughts towards the things that God is thinking about us, towards the desires that God has for us. That same power that raised Christ from the dead lives in me and you. So here's what I want you to know. If you don't take anything away from anything that I've said all day, when I get on a plane going back to Atlanta in a few hours, I hope you're still thinking this thought. There is greatness in you. There's greatness in you. Turn to your neighbor and say, there's greatness in you. Now turn to the person that was your second choice and say, there's greatness in you too. There's greatness in you. It's not your own greatness. It's not your own power. It's not the things you got an A+ and a gold star for in school. It's not because you're so awesome and you've got great charisma and you're very gifted. It is the greatness of God that exists in you, because when He's looking across the landscape of the earth, I believe He looked right at you. And He said, this is a person that I can place my greatness in. Amen. This is an individual that I can put my greatness and my power in to accomplish the things on the earth. But that seems a little too big. So before we zoom out and we look at the whole earth, this is a person that I can put my greatness in to accomplish the things in this community in Texas. This is a person that I can put my greatness in to make a difference on their job and in their school. Amen. This is a person I can put my greatness in. And they can serve within the local church and help to point people to life in Jesus Christ. There is greatness in God's power and for God's purposes, and He places that greatness in you. So it's time to stretch. Amen. It's time to stretch. Amen. And here's what I know about stretching. It's not always comfortable. It's not always comfortable. sometimes I'll lay on the floor because my lower back will be hurting or my legs will be sore from something. I've been working out in the yard or doing something. And I'll say to one of my boys, hey, I want you to come over here and stretch my legs, which they interpret to mean I want you to come hurt me intentionally. I'll be like, okay, you need to go do something else. Because if I can ever get up, I'm coming after you. But I need you to come. And when they stretch me, man, it doesn't always feel great. But you know what that stretching is doing? It's creating more capacity. It's creating more room. It's creating an opportunity for me to accomplish more than I ever thought was possible. Right. And I believe that God desires for every person in this room and every person that's watching online today to stretch. Stretch your thinking. Stretch your perspective about who God is. Stretch your understanding about His ability to accomplish what He desires to accomplish in and through you. Stretch what you're thinking. The more you stretch what you're thinking and hoping and imagining, the more God has got to stretch His because He's got to stay out in front of you. The more I say, hey, I'm going to think a new thought. I'm going to dream a bigger dream. God's still got to exceed that dream. So He's got to dream a bigger dream and think a bigger thought and think new thought. I think all of us need to stretch our minds and stretch our hearts and stretch our spirits to believe that God is able to do exceedingly, abundantly, above all that we can ask or imagine through His power in us. Amen. That's what the future of His Place Church looks like. That's what the future of this church looks like. The question is, are you going to be a part of that future? Are you going to be a part of what God is desiring to do here? I believe in the days that we're living, God is trying to unify His church around the mission to help people that are lost and are searching to find hope. There's so much hopelessness that they would be able to come into a place just like this and experience the hope of Jesus Christ. I want to be a part of that. I want to be a part of that in my community. I want to stay a part of that in this community. I want us to all together to lock arms, be shoulder to shoulder and hand to hand, to say, God, I'm in. Stretch me. Use me. Create more capacity. Help us to create more emptiness that You might fill it. And God, I'm asking that as You would do that, that You would stretch our faith and stretch our finances and stretch our bodies and stretch our minds and stretch this church to accomplish more than we ever thought possible because of Your power at work in us. So here's what I want you to do. I don't know how you always do this, how you feel comfortable with this. I'm going to ask you right where you're at just to bow your head just for a moment. Just for you to close your eyes, bow your head. Nobody's going to walk around, do anything crazy to you. This is just a moment of personal reflection between you and God. Just an opportunity for you to take everything that you've heard and everything you experienced in our time of worship and every prayers that we prayed and everything that we've done today. And just to say, God, I'm asking You to help me to find the parts of this that connect to who I am and who You're calling me to be. And if You would say to me today, Jeremy, for me, I know I'm not in a relationship with Jesus Christ. I'm not sure I could pray to God and ask God to do anything because I'm not in relationship with Him, and I want to change that today. I want Him to be the Lord and Savior of my life. We're going to pray for you in just a second. If that's you, would you just lift your hand? You can put it right down in just a second. Thank you so much. Thank you so much. Thank you so much. And now if you would say, Jeremy, for me, I just want to stretch. I want to believe God for more and trust God for more and ask God for more. I want to see Him do exceedingly abundantly in and through my life. If that's you, would you just lift your hand? Thank you so much. So many hands today. I'm assuming there are on those that are watching online as well. I want everybody to just look at me for just a second. We're going to pray. So many hands today in both of these opportunities to pray, those for salvation and those that are asking God to stretch them. So here's what I want you to do. I just want you to pray. When I pray, I don't want you just to have me pray over you or pray for you. I want you to pray a prayer. And I want it to be a big, bold prayer, because remember that God honors bold prayers because bold prayers honor Him. Ask God for something big in your life. Ask God for something specific that you need out of the right motives and the right heart that would show the power and glory of God. It starts with salvation. If you're already saved, then trusting God and believing Him by great faith for the things that He desires to do in and through you. Let's pray together. God, we love You today and we thank You. We thank You for the chance to gather together in a place like this. We thank You, God, for the opportunity to worship You and to pray to You and to trust You for great things. And God, I pray right now for every person that lifted their hand and they ask You to be the Lord and Savior of their life. I thank You, God, that You forgive sins and You lead and guide us. And so, God, we pray that. I pray that it's not just this decision moment, but God, it is a lifetime now of a relationship with you. So God, I pray that they would take the steps to grow in relationship with you, to point their lives toward who you are and to trust you more than they ever have before. And God, now I pray for every person that's asked you to stretch them, to stretch their perspective, to stretch their minds and their hearts. And God, as they do that, I pray, Lord, that you would help them to be filled with great faith, that God, you don't just meet the need, that you exceed the need. So God, would you meet these incredible, bold prayers that they're praying right now? God, would you do what only you can do in and through their lives? And God, would they give you the glory for those things? And God, I lastly pray for this incredible church. I pray for Pastor Doug and for Kim. I pray, God, for the leaders within this church. I pray, God, that you would keep a great vision before them of what it is that you desire to do through this church. And God, I pray that our hearts would be turned towards the people that are still searching for you, those that are still longing for the hope that's available through Jesus Christ, that they would come in to this place and experience the power and the presence of Almighty God. And God, I pray what has already been said several times today, that it's not just our hope, but it is our firm confidence and belief that the best days of His Place Church are before us. And so God, we trust you to accomplish your dreams for this church. And God, we thank you for those things. In Jesus' name we pray. And everybody said, amen, amen and amen.